Yeah. It's me. Sitting in the sunset. There's a lot of haze in the air out there in the west where the ocean is. That ocean is cold because the current comes south from the Arctic, from the north, and sweeps down the coast of California, down all the way past Baja California, south toward the tropics. Here it's still cold, although it's almost warm enough to be comfortable now. It's getting into the upper 60s Fahrenheit. It's about 18 or 19 or 20 degrees Celsius. When it gets a little warmer, it's much more tolerable. For years, I would go swimming every summer in the sea. I haven't, well, I've walked in the edge of the waves, but I haven't been swimming in about 10 years. I remember when I was in school in my 30s, I actually lived there by the university, which is on the hill above the ocean. And I would walk down the canyon path to the water. And one day I saw our neighbor there. She found a crab hiding in a hole under a rock. She pointed it out to me. She spoke Spanish. Her husband divorced her and moved back east to work for the military. And I went back to the city and the county of San Diego, where I'd worked before. Already by then, through my 20s and 30s and 40s, I worked for the county and the city of San Diego. And some shops, too. Yeah. So, I came to this house when I was 28. And then, after about 5 or 10 years, I started being asked to live here while the parents were gone, for a week or 2 weeks, sometimes a whole month. And I was here for a while. Let's see. No, I was not here during the fire. My brother was house sitting here in the fire. That's when I still lived out at the university. Yeah, that fire was 32 years ago now. That was something. We're lucky this house survived. The house next door on that side did, and the house next door on that side survived. Both our neighbors and we survived. But the houses beyond this next door house, there were three houses along that side of the street that burned down. And the other direction, you go back out around to the house that blocks the sun in winter. Sunset in winter goes, that's where that corner of the street is over there. That house is new. It was rebuilt after the fire. And it's right next door to the monastery. The convent, which did not burn down. I believe there was some damage to the house next door to the monastery. And then a couple doors down, there were some houses along that stretch of the street that burned. And then off in the whole greater part of the neighborhood, there were dozens of houses destroyed. Sometimes whole blocks were reduced to people were fond of calling it Beirut. It looks like Beirut has been bombed. You've all seen pictures in the newspaper of burned out streets with dead houses, everything covered with ash, and the cars nothing but melted shapes. Yeah. That was the legacy of the fire here 32 years ago. Let's see, 1986 to 96 would be 10 years. To 2006 would be 20 years. And to 2016 would be 30 years. And then it's two more years to 2018, where I'm sitting and talking to the camera. Well, the sun's not going to set for another hour yet. This is only a few days after the summer solstice. And I'm sitting here, as you saw, I think when I began the camera pan around, I showed my drink, my potion. This is a really beautiful piece. It has layers in it, you see. Let's see if I can get it in the sunlight. Yes. It has layers. Layers of color and layers of light. Well, there's some sunlight. Yes. It's cranberry juice and tequila. This is my second one. This one, there's a little more cranberry juice than there was in the last one. That'll probably take me. I'm not very thirsty. That's the trouble with having a drink. You know, sometimes you're just thirsty and you gulp the damn thing. But, you know, when you're thirsty for water. Aren't we all? Alcohol is a different thirst. It's a kind of... Well, there's the whole burning aspect, the chemical reaction with the body and the heat it produces, or the sensation of heat, which actually is false. When you're in cold weather and you drink and you feel warm, you're not. And it also makes you thirstier. The more you drink, the thirstier you get, because it's not pure water. It's got all the other chemical additives in it, like ethyl alcohol, or is it methyl? No, methyl's the poison one, that's right. So, here I am, talking on the, let's see, the timer says I can have 33 minutes of battery power. I don't think I'll be talking that long. I just noticed, however, that it had been a few days since my last little game with playing the piano to Trump giving a speech. So I thought, well, I'll make something. I'm kind of coming back out of a very deep shell where I went. My stepbrother was over today, and it was kind of fun just to sit around and chat with him. And I noticed that feeling. I was having this warm feeling. So I told him about it. He said, well, glad to hear you trying to get back on your feet emotionally. He's suffering a lot. He lost his... He lost his husband. It's been a hard year. Bob died in the autumn, just last year, before Christmas. And then, of course, in March, just after the spring began, Marjorie died. Bob once gave her a sign that she put on the refrigerator and it's still there. It says, cocktail hour. 5 a.m. to 4:59 a.m. Well, I usually don't drink in the morning, unless it's after midnight and I'm still up. But that's something else that's worried me a little bit lately, and I'm starting to feel a little more confident about it since so many days and weeks have gone by. But I still have to watch out for that devil alcohol, the demon rum. Look, there's a patch of sunlight shining on my eyeball. Anyhow, so I find myself thinking that maybe I am drinking more. Maybe I am becoming an alcoholic. Well, I suppose I've always been an alcoholic. It's just that my switch hasn't been thrown yet. I know my daddy was. I saw him in the grip of it. It was pretty devilish. When you get that and you're not conscious, really not conscious of what you're doing, but your brain is active and your mouth is moving and saying things like, give me another drink, damn it. Shut up and give me another drink. Well, he never actually said that. He wasn't even that vicious. He was a sad old drunk. More neglectful than abusive. So, my brother and I didn't know about it until we were quite old, like 10, 12 years old. I think my brother understood when he was about 7 or 8, because he was 8 years younger than I was, and of course my dad started drinking more after his mother died, which is why I am worried. You see, this timing is impeccable. But it was 1963, and he was 42 years old when his mother died. She was 73. Now, I am 67 years old this year, and I will be 68 years old this year my mother has died. So there's a difference from 42 to 67. And that's part of it. Also, although I do have a history of smoking and drinking, never to the extent that my father did. Well, what can I say? He was one of those mild alcoholics, and everybody helped him along, have a drink, da-da-da-da. Well, anyhow, the subject of alcohol weighs heavily upon my heart, and I often wonder if that's why I listen with a fond ear to the preachings of the Prophet Muhammad. You know, they're not allowed to drink alcoholic beverages in the Islamic religion. Well, it's been a while now, and I've talked a long time. And I think I'm just going to turn off this little camera and wish you all Godspeed. And see you next time, and don't forget yourselves to make a vlog and let us know how you're doing. Bye.